during the last months of World War II. Allied forces advance into Germany. On April 14, 1945, the US Third Army discovers a top-secret facility hidden in the forest, 93 miles northeast of Frankfurt. The soldiers jump down from the truck and walk towards the abandoned factory premises. Inside, they find some strange aircraft prototypes with almost alien forms made of steel and wood. One of Nazi Germany's most advanced weapons. Shortly afterwards, a specialist team from the US, Operation Paperclip, arrived to investigate the aircraft. They quickly selected the most complete aircraft for immediate delivery to USA. The rest were ordered to be destroyed. The important new weapon technology was absolutely not allowed to arrive in the hands of the Red Army. Some distance away from the facility, a pair of wings were found and were shipped along with the airframe and other advanced Nazi planes to the US under the codename Operation Seahorse for intensive studies and evaluations. What the Americans had found was the strange and ultra-modern Horten 229, a jet engine-powered flying wing. In the early 1930s, the brothers Walter and Reimer Horten had become interested in the so-called flying wing design in order to thereby improve the gliding ability of their gliders. The special wing layout would remove all unnecessary surfaces, it was said, at least in theory, to the lowest possible weight. In 1943, Reich Marshal Göring had a competition announced where the completed aircraft would be able to carry a load of 1,000 kilos over 1,000 kilometers at a speed of 1,000 kilometers per hour, the so-called 3x1,000 rule. At this time, there were no easy ways to reach them set goals, but with Junkers' new jet engine Jumo 004B had no problem getting up to the set speed. It was already used in the fighter plane Messerschmitt 262. The disadvantages of the engine were that the jet turbines could easily overheat and start burning. It was difficult to obtain good metals in the final stages of the war. The Horten brothers concluded that the design of the aircraft's wings with low air resistance could meet all objectives. Göring believed in the design and ordered a production run of 40 aircraft with the designation HO-229. Because the Horten brothers lacked suitable production facilities, the 229's production was outsourced to Gother Wagenfabrik. The test flights were made at the airport in Oranienburg outside Berlin. The first flight of version 2 took place on February 2, 1945, without a problem. The test pilot was Lieutenant Erwin Ziller. They also tried flying at high altitudes. The pilot then wore a special pressure suit to cope the pressure at 15,000 meters. The third test flight was made on February 18, 1945. After repairs to the plane came the order to no more starts without permission from the Horten brothers. But Ziller is still test flying. Maybe Soviet troops was near the area, or did he want to end the test flights as quickly as possible? Ziller takes off without a problem to perform a series of flight tests. After about 45 minutes and a height of about 800 meters, one of the turbojet engines had trouble, caught fire, and stopped. Ziller puts the aircraft in one dive and pull it up several times, in an attempt to start the engine and save the precious prototype. He conducts a series of four 360-degree turns with the wings at a 20-degree angle. He did not use his radio or eject from the aircraft. He may have already been unconscious from the fumes from the burning engine. The plane crashes just outside the airport boundary. Zilla was thrown from the aircraft on impact and died of his injuries, and the aircraft was completely destroyed. It is also claimed that before takeoff, a technician had seen that there was a problem with the right turbine engine, but no spare part was available. Despite this setback, continued the project with the same energy. Same month, work began on the third prototype, Horten 229 version 3. The V3 was larger than previous prototypes. The form was modified in various areas, and it was supposed to be a template for a pre-production series, of which 20 machines had been ordered. But everything was too late, and no prototypes of the Horten 229 came to be mass-produced or join the war. When the American in 1945 transported the only remaining Horten 229 to the United States, it was evaluated both by British and American researchers before it went into long-term storage at the National Air and Space Museum. Unfortunately, the aircraft has suffered as it was outside for some time. The wood has cracked in places, and there is rust on the steel pipes. In December 2011, had the museum moved the aircraft to the Gaber Restoration Facility. The plane is currently being inspected for restoration and display. Closest to experience a Horten 229 flying for real is to watch when this radio-controlled model starts. Thank you for watching this documentary.